You're the my enemies on every side. I'm tempted to run and hide. Your gentle whisper reaches out to me. Crashing down, I fall to my knees.
morning, everybody. Let's all stand to our feet. We're gonna hands together like this.
I could not climb. desperation, I turned to him, spoke your name into the night. And through the darkness, your loving kindness tore through the shadows of my soul.
Cannot be overcome.
name is alive, forever lifted high. Your name cannot be overcome. Sing that, your name. Your name is alive, that the shadows can't deny. Your name cannot be overcome. Oh, your name is alive, forever lifted high. Your name cannot be overcome. Say, I'm Jesus. Jesus, Jesus. You make the darkness tremble, Jesus, Jesus. Silence fear, Jesus, Jesus. You make the darkness tremble, Jesus, Jesus.
Sing that again.
Sing out, Jesus, Jesus. You make the darkness tremble,
Jesus, Jesus.
Silence fear,
you silence fear.
Oh, we sing out.
Darkness tremble, Jesus, Jesus.
Your name is alive. Yes, your name is alive, that the shadows can't deny. Your name cannot be overcome. Your name is alive, for be overcome. One more time. Your name is, your name is a lie that the shadows can't deny. Your name cannot be overcome. Your name is a lie forever lifted high. Your name cannot be overcome.
It's hallelujah.
Hallelujah, praise the one who set me free. Hallelujah, death has lost its grip on me. You have broken every chain. There's salvation in your name, Jesus Christ, my living. Oh, Jesus Christ, Jesus Christ, my living. God, you are my living hope. The Lord bless you and keep you. Make his face shine upon you. Be gracious to you. Lord, turn his face toward you and give you peace.
Just sing and speak this over you. Sing it with us. The Lord bless you.
Lord bless and keep. Make his face shine upon you. Lord, turn. Lord, turn his face toward you and give you.
Amen.
We say,
thank you.
let's agree together, amen. We say,
powerful prayer. You know, that's the prayer that God gave to Moses to pray over the children of Israel. Isn't that beautiful? And so we can pray that over our families. I know when my grandkids have an overnight, I pray that every night. May the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord make his face to shine upon you and be gracious to you. May the Lord lift up his countenance upon you. What a beautiful promise. What a beautiful thing that we can pray over our children, over our families. Wow, what a beautiful thing to gather together. I'm just so grateful. I'm just so grateful that we can be here today and gather together and lift him up and lift up our voices to him. Can we just lift up our hands to him this morning? Father, we love you in this place. With our voice, we will declare the goodness of God. With our voice, we will lift up. We will lift up our voice in praise to you because you are worthy of our praise. You are worthy to be lifted. Thank you, God, that we can gather together. There's power when we gather together as the children of God. There's power when we lift up your name together. And there is power when we worship you together. Thank you, God, that you are exalted in this place.
Yes.
Thank you, God, that your name is lifted in this place.
Hallelujah.
And we declare that you're going to have your way here today. Your kingdom come, your will be done. And we declare that in Jesus' name. And everyone in agreement said,
amen
and amen.
Hallelujah. Come on, give the Lord a big praise. Praise the Lord. How many are happy to be in the house of the Lord this morning? Amen. Good to see you. Really awesome to see you. Go ahead and be seated right there where you're standing. You know, it's a big week for us. We had a new addition to our family. Vic, come on up here for a minute. Want to introduce you to our newest. And what a gift from God. Little Sailor. Come on up here, you guys, and let's introduce her to us. And Vic, come on up. Thank you, Lord. Little Sailor was born on Thursday. Can you imagine that? Thursday. And 5 pounds, 4 ounces. Isn't she precious? It's the prettiest little girl I've ever seen. Hallelujah. And Mom's doing awesome. You can see that. And Dad's doing amazing. And anything you want to say, babes?
Well, I just am so thankful for health, and I'm so thankful for family. You know, the Bible talks a lot about God's power and God's anointing being passed on from generation to generation. And so a few weeks ago when I was in church with my mom, we surprised her and was sitting in church with her, I thought, what a beautiful thing to be able to sit together in church with your family. And even if your family is far away or your natural family is far away, your church body becomes your family. And there's just something powerful about family. Standing together, praying together, agreeing together, worshiping together. And so the beautiful thing about Sailor is that she's being brought up in the house of God. And the Bible says that goodness and mercy will follow her all the days of her life. Amen.
Thank you. Thank you. What a gift. What a precious gift. You know, also this week, Reagan. Where's Reagan? Is Reagan here this morning? Reagan was born. And is she here? Out in the lobby? Okay. Oh, okay. She's not. Reagan was also born. She was like 9 pounds. So if we put those two babies side by side, about half and half. But praise God. Let's just stretch our hands out towards Tara and Adam and our precious, precious gift this morning. And hon, I just want you to pray a blessing over her today. Thank you.
Hallelujah. Father, we do thank you for children. We thank you that they are truly a gift from God. And Father, I just thank you that as Sailor's brought up in the house of God, and Reagan and any other little child that is brought here to Destiny as part of the family, thank you that the word is going to be imparted into them, that you've promised that goodness and mercy will follow them all the days of their life. And I just declare that they will dwell in the house of the Lord forever. Thank you that your word says that you already have a plan for every life, a plan and a purpose. And the plans that you have for us are good and not for evil. And I thank you for that. And we just declare your goodness over this new life today. And we thank you, God, for your faithfulness. In Jesus' name. And everyone said, amen.
Amen. Amen. Praise God. Maybe I can hold her during service this morning. Praise the Lord. You know, we're actually having a baby dedication the last Sunday of September. We're having a water baptism, and we're also going to have a baby dedication, both on the same day, the last Sunday of September. So just kind of keep that date in mind, and get signed up. If you have a baby that you'd like dedicated, or a child that's never been dedicated, or if you'd like to be baptized, immersed in water, fully baptized, we'll be doing that. And you'll hear more about that in the weeks ahead for sure. This morning, we've got a special service for you guys. We've got life groups kicking up. And here in September, it's a life group month again. We're going to be running life groups into September, October, November. And we're going to take a little time this morning not to do advertising as much as you're going to hear some word, and you're going to be challenged today and blessed today. But we are going to announce the different life groups that you can get participating in and get signed up for. And so Pastor Tyler oversees our life groups, and I just want him to come up, say whatever he wants, and then he's going to introduce our life group leaders for this season, okay? So Pastor Tyler, come on up today and let us know everything going on.
Yeah, well, I am super excited for the life groups that are kicking off here in September. We've got five or six different groups, if you include Men of Destiny, which has been going on since, well, that always happens on the last Monday of every month, but five new groups kicking off in September in addition to Men of Destiny. And so we're going to hear about those groups before we introduce all the different life group leaders, and you're going to hear some word taught today. Let's go ahead and play the life group promo video, and then we'll hear from our life group leaders. All right, so we've got, as I said, we've got different life groups kicking off right here in September next week. Some of them are starting up as soon as next week, I believe. And so I can encourage you guys, and as you saw in that video, life groups is more than just coming to church. Life groups is your opportunity to be a part of a community and to be a part of something more than just coming to church on Sunday mornings, but to really develop some relationships with other people and to grow in your walk with God more than just hearing a word on a Sunday morning. How many of you know you can't just grow? You're not going to become very spiritually strong if you only attend church on a Sunday morning, right? You've got to be getting in the Word yourself. You need to be getting into a connection group, a life group, where you guys can feed each other and sharpen each other. The Bible says, as iron sharpens iron, so does one man sharpen another. And that's what life groups are all about, is getting together in a community, sharpening each other, and getting together outside of just a Sunday morning service. And so the first group that we're going to hear about today, my wife leads this group, the lovely, the gorgeous, the beautiful Pastor Jessica. And she leads our Women of Destiny, and they're going to be doing a book study. So I'm going to have her share a little bit about that and then give you some word this morning.
All right. Well, we were actually supposed to kick this off back in March, but we all know what happened in March. So the ladies who are newer to the church, who have signed up, you guys are in for a treat because now you get to join us. We'll be meeting here in the sanctuary Wednesday nights at 7 o'clock. We start September 9th, so not this Wednesday, but the following Wednesday. We're going to be doing Jenny Allen's Get Out of Your Head. If you cannot join us, I would highly encourage to get the book. You only need the study guide to attend the class, but the book. There's so much meat. We have a DVD we'll be watching every week, and then we'll be going through some discussion questions. So there is homework. So if you don't like a class with homework, this probably isn't the class for you. There's not a lot of homework, but it's good. It's just put it along with your devotions in the morning. It's really easy homework, 10, 15 minutes to add on top of your devotions in the morning or at night whenever you do them. So I'm so excited to do this book. I will preface by saying most of what I'm saying this morning is straight out of her book. There is so much meat and amazing stuff. I'm like, I'm not even going to make my own message. I'm just going to take what we're going to be talking about from her book and in the study guide and through all that. So we'll be doing that. We won't be able to be Zoom or online because of copyright and stuff. So if you're wanting to try and be in the group that way, we can't do that because of copyright. But so let me get started. It is called Get Out of Your Head, and I can you probably know where we're going with this. It's talking about stopping the spiral of toxic thoughts. The greatest spiritual battle of our generation is being fought between our ears. We've all heard the phrase, think about what you're thinking about, but how are we applying that to our lives? How do we break the cycle of stopping those negative thoughts that seem to creep in? And then all of a sudden, they've unpacked their boxes. They've moved up into the room, and they don't seem to have any plans on leaving. Our emotions are leading us to thoughts. Those thoughts are dictating our decisions. Our decisions determine our behavior, and the behaviors are shaping our relationships, all of which cycle back to either healthy or unhealthy thoughts. The average person has more than 30,000 thoughts a day. You realize that? 30,000 thoughts a day. And all of our negative thoughts fit into one of three categories. This is scientific information that I'm pulling now. So you're like, no, way more than. There's only three categories. You can look it up. There's been studies done. But they fit into either one of these three categories. All of your negative thoughts either fit into, I'm helpless, I'm worthless, or I am unlovable. Only three categories, and all of our thoughts filter through one or two or sometimes all three of those categories in one day. These lies shape our thinking, our emotions, the way we respond to the world around us. They trap us in a cycle of distraction and distortion and pain, preventing us from recognizing the truth that we should believe. But most detrimentally, they change our view of who God is. Every lie we buy into about ourselves is rooted in what we believe about God. You know, we may read in our Bibles that God loves us, he's got a great plan for us and a purpose for us. And though you read those words, if you never take hold of those negative lies, lies that I'm worthless, I'm unlovable, I'm unhelpless, how can we truly believe that there is a God that loves us and has a good plan for us? People every day fail us, say unkind things to us. And maybe you don't even hear those things, but in your thought life, that is going on. Someone doesn't even have to say that to you, and you believe that I'm not worth someone's love, I'm never going to be good enough. Those may not be the exact words in the script of your head, but watch your thoughts this week. Take an account of the negative thoughts that come and line them up with one of those three categories. How many other thoughts line up in those categories that you just believe because that's how it's always been, and I can't change the way I think? Well, let me tell you a secret this morning. Let me tell you something that may blow your mind. But you can change your thinking. You can change your thought process. It's not going to happen overnight. It's not going to happen because I'm telling you it's going to happen. It's not going to happen just because you want it to happen. No, it's going to take work. Daily work on your part to catch those thoughts, to not let them sit there and take up residence in your mind and in your heart. Those negative thoughts don't deserve to take up residence in you as a believer because Christ already won the battle. He won the battle over your thought life. He won the battle for you to walk in a beautiful and purposeful life. If our thought lives are the deepest, darkest places of stronghold within us, all of hell will stop you from trying to be free. I'm going to say that again. If our thought lives are the deepest, darkest places of stronghold within us, all hell will try to stop us from being free. Those thoughts may have deep roots that have grown in you for years and years. How many of you all like weeds? Nobody likes weeds. And I'm weird about weeds. Like, I'll pick up weeds at parks. I'll pick up weeds in other people's yards. I just don't like weeds. But I get really excited when I pull up a weed and it comes out and the root comes out. And I'm like, yes. But there are some of those weeds you have to take that shovel to and you have to dig it out. And then the next week it's back and you're like, there are going to be some of those thoughts that have taken root in you for so long that it's going to take time to dig them out. And you may feel that thought coming back in, and you're going to have to dig it back out using the Word of God, using prayer. You're going to have to fight to keep killing that root over and over. But I believe if you keep at it, I believe if you get an action plan into place to stop the spiral of negative thoughts, you are going to get victory. And you just start with one thought. You don't have to start with all the thoughts. Start with one thought. And you get victory over that one thought. And then it becomes two and three and four. And after years of deep, dark, spiraling thoughts that have held you captive, living in fear, I believe you will see the light. I want to read out of 2 Corinthians chapter 10 this morning. I'm reading this out of the Message, so it kind of puts verses 3 through 6 together, but it says, the world is unprincipled. It's dog-eat-dog out there. The world doesn't fight fair, but we don't live or fight our battles that way. Never have, never will. The tools of our trade aren't for marketing or manipulation, but they are for demolishing that entire massively corrupt culture. We use our powerful God tools for smashing warped philosophies, tearing down barriers erected against the truth of God, fitting every loose thought and emotion and impulse into the structure of life shaped by Christ. Our tools are ready at hand for clearing the ground of every obstruction and building lives of obedience into maturity. We have been equipped with the power from God to tear down strongholds in our minds, to destroy the lies that dominate our thought patterns, and we have the power and authority to do this. Yet we walk around as if we have no power. We walk around letting whatever thought come in and those negative thoughts dominate it. So how do we do this? How do we change that thought process? One simple thing is, I have a choice. You have a choice. If you have received the free gift of salvation from our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ, you have the power of God living on the inside of you to make that choice about what you are thinking about. You have a choice where you focus your energy. You have a choice regarding what you're going to live for. So what are you fixating on? What are you thinking about all the time? When we think new thoughts, we physically alter our brain. When we think new thoughts, we blaze new trails. When we think new thoughts, everything changes for us. I'm going to end with this. When we're spiraling in noise or distractedness, we have a choice to shift our minds back to God through stillness. When we're spiraling in isolation, we have a choice to shift our minds back to God through community. When we're spiraling in anxiety, we have a choice to shift our minds back to God through trust in His good and sovereign purposes. When we're spiraling in cynicism, we have a choice to shift our minds back to worship. When we're spiraling in self-importance, we have a choice to shift our minds back to God through humility. When we're spiraling into victimhood, we have a choice to shift our minds back to God through gratitude. And when we're spiraling in complacency, we have a choice to shift our minds back to God through serving Him and others. So I just want to say a prayer over you guys this morning, over your thought life, over your mind. Maybe you won't be able to join us in our study. It is a women's group, so unfortunately, men, I know you're dying to be part of the women's group, but I encourage you men to get the book and read the book. It's on Audible, it's on Amazon, or you can just borrow your wife's book. It's all right, we won't tell. But it's going to be good. We're going to be going through Philippians, studying the book of Philippians while we go through this study, kind of digging deeper into Philippians. So it'll be good. But let me pray for you all. Heavenly Father, I just pray for every single person in this room under the sound of my voice, Lord. All that we've heard this morning through Jenny's book, through the nuggets that we have received this morning, I pray that we will take action to those thoughts. We won't just let them creep in and take up residence and just sit there in our minds. But I thank you, Lord, that we will take every thought captive and we will make it obedient to you, Lord. We know, Lord, that every negative thought, every lie is from the enemy and from the pit of hell, and that's where we send it back to. And Lord, I pray our minds be filled with joy, peace, love, goodness. I thank you, Father, that we will walk as Christ followers, taking captive those thoughts. In Jesus' mighty name, we pray. Amen.
I love her so much. She is my greatest blessing. Absolutely. Women of Destiny, that's on Wednesdays at 7 p.m. right here in the sanctuary, so we can have plenty of ladies. There's plenty of room for all of you because it's right in this room. So ladies, make sure you register. By the way, after service today, you can also register at the kiosk. But if you have your smartphone or your tablet, you can go online, open up your app, and register for all of these life groups that you're hearing about today. So ladies, be sure to sign up for Women of Destiny, and that book study is going to be awesome. The next leader that we're going to hear from, we're launching again Celebrate Recovery here at the church, and I'm so excited to be launching again Celebrate Recovery. Celebrate Recovery is a national, you could call it a national life group. It's got a nationwide reputation of really setting people free from their hurts, habits, and hang-ups, and I'm so excited to have a guy. He's been a blessing to our church. He hasn't actually been here long. He started attending earlier this year in 2020, and he came from an awesome church here in the Twin Cities, and he has really been a godsend to Destiny. And so before we hear from him, let's check out this video about Celebrate Recovery.
Oh, what I would do to have the kind of faith it takes to climb out of this boat I'm in, under the crashing waves, to step out of my comfort zone into the realm of the unknown, where Jesus is and He's holding out His hand. But the waves are calling out my name and they laugh at me, reminding me of all the times tried before and failed. The waves, they keep on telling me time and time again, boy, you never win, you never win. But the voice of truth tells me a different story. The voice of truth,
so this group is going to be meeting Friday nights at 6:30 upstairs in our Odyssey classroom. And I want to introduce to you right now Mr. Rick Blanchard to come and share. And Rick Blanchard, again, he's been such a blessing to not only this ministry, but to me personally. I love him. He's a great guy. And you're going to be blessed by his word today.
Thank you, Pastor. Good morning, church. My name is Rick Blanchard. And first of all, I'd like to say thank you to the pastors for supporting Celebrate Recovery. It fits very well in with Destiny's theme of basically restoring through the mercy, hope, and life of Jesus Christ. So it really fits in well. And sorry if I'm a little nervous. It's been a while since I've been in front of so many people. Too much social isolation, people. So what is Celebrate Recovery, or CR as we call it? It's quite different than other 12-step groups. You might think of, you know, Alcoholics Anonymous or some of the other 12-step groups out there that talk about a God of our understanding, which is quite flawed. When I grew up Catholic, and the God of my understanding was an angry, vengeful God that would send you to hell for the slightest thing. The nuns would tell you every day, you know, don't mess up. And so what really is, it's a biblical-based 12-step group based on the Beatitudes of Christ. And we have a slide that we can put up that shows some of the biblical references to the Bible. And we rely on the highest power, not just a higher power of understanding, but the highest power, Jesus Christ. CR is a spiritual growth discipleship program, and it's designed to help people live a free life devoted to a right relationship with Jesus Christ. So it's not so much a religion, it's a relationship with God and Jesus. And it's designed to help broken and hurting people. And who isn't broken and hurting? If you're born and you have a belly button, you've probably been broken and hurting. It also helps us to overcome life's adversities, to discover not only freedom, but healing from our hurts, habits, and hang-ups. CR is for anyone who wants to discover true freedom and experience genuine joy and purpose in life. It's truly a program that anyone and everyone should attend. What is a hurt, habit, or hang-up? It's something that will hinder your walk with God. So the feeling of being hurt, I think we've all felt that, is an emotional reaction to another person's behavior or to a disturbing situation such as abuse, abandonment, codependency, divorce, or other relationship issues. A habit can be an addiction to someone or something. Examples include alcohol, drugs, food, gambling, sex, shopping, smoking, and pornography, just to name a few. Hang-ups are negative mental attitudes that are used to cope with people or adversity. Some examples include anger, depression, fear, and unforgiveness. And let's see, areas of help. So pretty much, like I said, it can cover anything, including drugs, alcohol, adult children of alcoholics, which I was growing up, abuse, anger, codependency, sexual addiction, eating disorders, food addiction, financial recovery, love and relationship help, gambling, shopping, and many, many more. Celebrate Recovery groups will be meeting beginning September 11th at 6 o'clock, as Pastor Tyler had mentioned. And we start out in a large group format that basically we start and rotate with a lesson and then followed by the next week a testimony. And then we also, in the lessons, teach about the 12 steps and the 8 principles in Celebrate Recovery. We then break down into small groups, which offers a personalized setting depending on the addiction, and dividing men and women into their own groups, because obviously men and women have their own issues, right? We then facilitate these small groups and basically want to provide accountability for everybody that's there. And we're also looking for new leaders to emerge as God continually appoints new leaders that can help us duplicate the leadership model that's so good in Celebrate Recovery. There's also going to be a deeper step study that brings recovery to a deeper relationship with God and others. This study meets with a more seasoned group from CR, and as the program develops sponsors and leaders, we most often will build very long-lasting relationships that God brings into the program and into our lives. So just want to kind of leave you with what CR has done for me. I grew up in a family of alcoholics, and it was quite normal for me at 5 years old to drink beer or wine or whatever. And, you know, I got into trouble as I grew up, as you can imagine, alcohol being a big part of my life. By the time I was 50, I had 4 DUIs and 4 broken relationships. And I was just at my wit's end. I was ready to give up and call it quits. And I got on my knees and I prayed to God, God, show me something different. I tried everything else, and God brought me to Celebrate Recovery. And it was there that I found love and acceptance. And they said, come as you are. And it didn't matter who I was or where I came from. It mattered that I was seeking Jesus. And that's what really changed my life. What CR and sobriety has granted me to do for the last 7 years is basically, I used to sit on the bar stool and dream about the things I used to want to do. But now I have the freedom to actually do those things. Remember, your story, thank you. It's all Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. And remember, it could be your story that helps unlock somebody else's prison. So don't be afraid to share it. 2 Corinthians chapter 12, verse 9 says, Jesus said to me, my grace is sufficient for you. My power is made perfect in weakness. Therefore, I will boast more gladly about my weakness so that Christ's power may rest upon me. It's amazing the people I tell my testimony to. I used to be ashamed of it, and people gravitate towards it because I think everybody can relate to a piece of brokenness in our lives. I'd like to pray for everybody, anyone that's struggling. I know this is a tough time of the year, and we've gone through a lot. There's a lot of people struggling, so if I could just pray for the church. Dear Jesus, please help us open our hearts to you with honesty. We know that in this world, we often wear the mask of, I'm fine. You know that our heart, in our heart, Lord, that it's not that we're not okay, but you tell us it's okay to come to you just as we are. We thank you for this, Jesus, and we come to you and ask you to enrich our lives with your love, grace, and mercy. In your precious Son, Jesus' name, amen. God bless you.
Rick, thank you so much. I know that wasn't easy for you to do. I know that public speaking is not something that comes natural to you, and I know you took a step of faith, and when we asked him to share about Celebrate Recovery, he did it because he knew it was important, and I just thank you for doing that, stepping out of your comfort zone to share about Celebrate Recovery. You're going to do awesome. I'm really excited for those of you who want to join Celebrate Recovery. It'll really change your life, as it did Rick's life. Amen? The third person that we're going to have speak and actually not just share about the group, but give you some word today is Pastor Kent. I love this guy. Anyone who knows Pastor Kent, you've walked away blessed. Whenever you talk to him, you walk away feeling better than before you talk to him. He just has a spirit and an aura about him. He's just got such a sweet spirit. Him and his wife, Becky, both are some of the sweetest, most compassionate people you will ever meet. And I love Pastor Kent. So Pastor Kent actually is also, as Pastor Jessica was saying, the women are actually going to be studying Philippians. So is Pastor Kent. I'm going to let Pastor Kent share more about that with his legacy group. Thank you, Pastor.
As I'm listening this morning, it's exciting to see how the groups are blending together in topic and in spirit. God must have a message for our church. And so he's using many avenues to touch your heart and life. And so I have the privilege of leading the group called Legacy. It is the 55 plus. If you're younger, you can come. It's all right. But it's designed for those that want to be together for fellowship. And the Legacy group, we're reminding one another that we have a powerful legacy as believers. We're building this entire ministry upon a framework that, number one, we desire to pass our faith in Jesus Christ onto our children and grandchildren and generations to follow. It is a great legacy we carry. We also want to know that we have a powerful legacy to serve our church, to serve our pastoral staff, to be praying for our faith community that's so important to us. We also are going to build on the framework that in our stage of life, we can bring a financial stability to the work of the church and the ministry as we are faithful to learn the power of tithing and giving and serving. That's a powerful legacy. And then we want to know that what we truly do with the legacy God's given us has eternal value. That we can touch someone's life that can actually change their eternity. And we want to know that that matters. And so we gather to encourage one another. We're going to accomplish this ministry in many avenues. We're going to enjoy times of fellowship, usually includes dessert. And we are going to meet together for times of worship and prayer. We're going to meet together to serve together, give together, and of course study God's word together. We love the Bible studies we've already enjoyed. We meet every Wednesday evening at 7 p.m. in the cafe area. You're welcome to come and join us. You can jump in at any time. You don't have to wait till the start of a new session. We are in motion, so come and join us. And then the first Sunday night of every month, we are going to be doing a fellowship and dessert time. This coming week, next Sunday night, September 6th, the fellowship is actually going to be at our home. Becky and I would like to invite all of you into our home to come and enjoy fellowship. And the dessert's going to be root beer floats. So come and join us as we have a great time together. As was mentioned, we are jumping into the book of Philippians. Philippians is a powerful book. It's written, of course, by the Apostle Paul, one of his letters to the churches that he planted. But he's at a stage in life where the Apostle Paul is actually in prison. He's in Rome. He's under house arrest. He is not in the dungeon that he later experiences. But when this letter is written, he is under house arrest. And it's interesting to study the history and the background and then to hear his heartbeat come through his letters. Of all the epistles or letters that Paul wrote, this is the only one that is not corrective. It is a letter of love. It's a letter of affirmation. It's a letter of encouragement. And it's interesting because the Apostle Paul never stopped doing what he was called to do. He is a prisoner, but he sees his circumstance as an opportunity to do something greater for God. I've got to imagine, I love to think these stories through. The Apostle Paul is under house arrest. There are two Roman soldiers chained to him on each arm. I feel sorry for those soldiers, because what's the conversation going to be? If you're chained to the Apostle Paul, you are not getting away from being witnessed to. And so we sometimes wonder, why am I in this circumstance? Maybe God has you there to be a witness. And he is not afraid of that. So he has a companion helping him. So again, he's under house arrest, but there's a young man named Timothy who was there to help him. But he is mentoring Timothy, and he is training him to be a leader in the church. And then, since he's in Rome, to the east is the city of Philippi. It is an affluent Roman community, and Paul planted a church there, and the church is now concerned for Paul in prison. And so they send a young man from the church in Philippi to bring a gift of offering and food and clothing to help Paul while he's under arrest. And this man is Epaphroditus. And so Epaphroditus comes bringing the gift. Paul's response to this overwhelming care for him is to write this letter of Philippians. And he sends it back to the church with Epaphroditus. And so what he is doing is he is returning a kindness, a written kindness, to what they showed to him. And when I understand that picture, I absolutely fall in love with verse 6. Chapter 1, verse 6. I'm going to read a couple of verses out of Philippians chapter 1. Paul writes, "I thank God every time I remember you." Verse 4, he says, "In all my prayers for all of you, I always pray with joy because of your partnership in the gospel from the first day until now." Verse 6, "Being confident of this, that he who began a good work in you will carry it on to completion until the day of Christ Jesus." He is seeing a greater vision of their lives than what they may see of themselves at the moment. He says, God has something more. God has a specific plan for you and for me. He says, the moment you responded to God, he put that plan into action. He chose to use you as a vessel for his glory. Think about what God's done. He's forgiven us. He's cleansed us. He's transformed our lives. And he's set us on a course that would bring glory and honor to his name. But when Paul said being confident of this, what he was saying is this is a lifelong process. It is not just a momentary experience. It is a lifelong process. That means we keep growing, we keep learning, we keep developing, we keep trusting. It is that lifelong process. God didn't start a work in your life and then walk away. Some have this picture like God took an old-fashioned alarm clock, wound it up, set it down, and then walks away. And when the alarm goes off, that's the end of your days. That is not the picture of God. He began a work in your life where he's involved in your life. He walks with you through life. He sustains you. He continues to be at work. It's an ongoing process. He has a deep desire to establish his plan in you. Let me encourage you with this. God's not quitting on you. Don't quit on him. God is not quitting on you. Don't quit on him. Let me encourage you with a very brief application. Number one, he who started the work will complete the work. He who started the work will complete the work. He promised. Paul said, being confident of this, that he who began a good work in you will bring it to completion upon the return of Jesus Christ. You realize God doesn't work half-hearted. God does not procrastinate. And God does not leave projects half-finished. I can be accused of all of those things. I can be accused of working half-hearted. I can be accused of procrastinating and leaving projects unfinished. God is not in that game. God has a plan that he will bring to completion. Let me give you a second encouragement. We must submit to this process. We must submit to the process. If God is doing a work in me, I need to submit to that. But you say, but I've failed and I've made so many mistakes. God's not done yet. I didn't get the success I thought I would get. He's not done yet. I haven't accomplished everything I've dreamed of accomplishing. He's not done yet. You see, if we see that the process is still happening, we know there is always room for improvement. There's always room for encouragement. We have to submit to the process. Let me tell you this. God is the master, and you are his masterpiece. But understand the submission in that. I have never known a painting to become a painter. I have never known a building to become a builder. I have never known a masterpiece to become the master. So if I understand that he is the master of my life, I submit to that process. He who began the work will bring it to completion. Number two, we must submit to the process. Number three, we must commit to the process. We must commit to the process. It's a spiritual development. At times it will be painful. At times we will feel like our life is being pruned, but it's only to produce more fruit. There's times that God will point down things we don't want to deal with, but God will bring them to light because he desires to complete the process of what he's doing in your life and in mine. All that he wants is for us to reflect his son, Jesus Christ. And you know, whatever it takes to get there, God's willing to go there because he wants us to reflect his son, Jesus Christ. One of my favorite authors is Max Lucado, and he wrote a book about coming into the image of Christ. He says, God will take you as you are, but he loves you too much to leave you that way because he has a process to make you into who he desires you to be. Stay committed to him. You see, the commitment comes to completion when we stand before God at the end of our days. So when is God done working on Kent? It's when I stand before him. That's when that process will come to completion. Because I long to hear those words, well done, good and faithful servant. If I quit early on the process, I'll never get to the completion. Remember, God does not quit on you. Don't quit on him. Can you say in your heart, being confident of this, that he who began a good work in me will bring it to completion upon the day of Jesus Christ? Father, I pray over every heart in this place today. I'm believing, God, that you are at work in each life. No matter where each of us see our own progress, you see something greater. Because you can see the completion, we can't. But Lord, we know that what you've begun in us, you and you alone will bring to completion. We also know, Lord, that we need to submit to the process and commit to this lifelong journey of growing in you. And Lord, we are confident not in ourselves, but confident in you. Lord, I thank you for each one. If there's anyone here that has contemplated quitting, give them a new strength today. Give them a new hope. Give them a new peace that God is still at work. God is not silent, and God is not unaware, but he is fully aware of what each of us are walking through, because he is the master, and we are the masterpiece in progress. I thank you for that. In Jesus' powerful name, amen.
Amen. Thank you, Pastor. Wow. That was awesome. So we've heard some great teaching today, and we're going to wrap things up now by hearing from our last two life group leaders. I'm going to have Jim Feary come on up. Jim Feary is leading an online life group. And so for those who are watching online today who may not be coming back into our physical buildings, we do have a group that is exclusively online, and it's called Break the Chains. And I'm going to let Jim Feary share briefly about Break the Chains.
Thank you. Well, like you said, it's an eight-week course, and I'm amazed how all these groups are tying together. I think maybe the Holy Spirit had something to do with that.
Yes, absolutely. It's awesome.
But I'll just read a scripture. Stand fast, therefore, in the liberty by which Christ made us free, and do not be entangled again with a yoke of bondage. That's Galatians 5:1. We don't realize it, but there are so many things in our lives. I don't know if anybody, has anybody ever moved, you know, to a different location? Did you notice that you had some stuff that you weren't aware of? And, well, that's where it went. Well, we do that emotionally. And this group is a complement to just about every group I've heard tonight or this morning. But it's a little bit deeper, where we're going to focus on your resentments, your fears, your harms, and also your positive inventory. And we're going to take these things before the Lord and break those chains. I'll mention one thing. For me, I didn't even know it, but I was struggling with betrayal. And I would make decisions. I would quit a job. I would, you know, change a direction just because I thought maybe I was going to be betrayed. And I didn't even know it. It was just, it just seemed logical to me. And God showed me that a history of betrayal was part of my decision process, that I was making decisions because I was afraid of being betrayed. And so this concept was part of setting me free from betrayal. And it's not like I still don't struggle with it even. I still have to use these tools to go, no, betrayal doesn't own me. I've been set free of that. So that's what the group's about. It'll start the last Sunday evening in September 27th at 6:30. It'll be via Zoom. And I'll say the video can be optional. I'm excited about it. God put it on my heart to bring here, to be honest, I didn't want to bring it here. But I when God says something, I decide to be obedient and do it. And so here it is. And if you want to participate, love to have you. And I just pray right now, any of you that have changed, things that are holding you back, things that, you know, you don't know why you make decisions, and you just want to be free of those, God, I ask that you put this on the hearts of people that want to be set free. I don't care if it's of addiction. I don't care what it's from. This will complement the other groups to really break these chains. We just thank you for it.
Amen. Thank you. Thank you, Jim, for sharing. And, you know, Jim is another one who, he told me leading a group isn't something that comes natural for him. And he approached me one Sunday. He's like, you know, this isn't something I would normally do. But he really felt that God was asking him to start a group for those who have hurts and betrayals and rejection and are dealing with these things, and it's something that he's experienced and he's been set free, and it was something that he felt he wanted to lead a life group for those certain people. And so I appreciate him again stepping out in obedience, obeying the leading of the Holy Spirit, and approaching me and asking me if he could lead a group. And I was excited for him. And also Ryan Berkness is co-leading that group. Ryan Berkness is especially responsible in getting him set up online through Zoom. He's the pro at the Zoom stuff. And so there's going to be a Zoom meeting online. So for details, again, register. And then Ryan and Jim will get you all the details on how to log in to that Zoom meeting online. Last group that we're going to share for just a minute is I'm going to have Melissa come up, but let's first, before you come up, let's watch a video about Financial Peace University.
What would happen if the people of God started handling money God's ways? You work too hard to get to the end of your life and have nothing to show for it.
This is my family's legacy that I'm talking about here. I've got to have a plan and be focused.
That knowledge that you pass down to your kids, that is how you change a family tree.
You change your life when you get sick and tired of being sick and tired. And you have that moment where you say, I've had it. I am not going to live like this anymore.
This is another group that was actually me and my wife, me and Pastor Jessica, took this class, and it has changed our life. So, Melissa, come on up and share with us today how Financial Peace University can change our lives.
Hi, everybody. I'm super excited to have this opportunity to work on my own financial freedom along with all of you who choose to join. And Dave Ramsey's awesome. He teaches on biblical principles, the seven baby steps towards financial freedom, which are the first one, save $1,000 for your starter emergency fund. Second, pay off all your debt, except the house, using the debt snowball. Thirdly, save 3 to 6 months of expenses in a fully funded emergency fund. 3B is save for down payment on a house. 4, invest 15% of your household income in retirement. 5, save for children's college fund. 6, pay off your home early. 7, build wealth and give. So he's super awesome. It's going to be a good class. I'm excited. And then Proverbs 22:7 says, just as the rich rule the poor, so the borrower is servant to the lender.
Yes. Financial Peace University, Dave Ramsey, I mean, he really does. It's changed our life. As I said, Jessica and I did this class, and we are now debt-free, aside from our home. Our home is the only debt that we have, and it's really because of what we learned in Financial Peace. And so I can't encourage you guys enough, if you want to set yourself up for success financially, learn the baby steps from Dave Ramsey on how to become debt-free and save for your future. Amen?
Yes.
Thank you so much.
Yeah.
Yes. Give Melissa a hand. That's going to be Saturdays Saturday mornings. We did it on Saturday so that as many people, again, I think everybody should take financial peace. If you haven't, you need to do it at some point in your life. So we did it Saturday so everybody can come at 10 a.m. That's going to be upstairs in the youth room. So Saturdays at 10 a.m. All these groups, again, are available to register for online through our app, out at the kiosk in the lobby before you leave. You can stop by there and register. But take a minute and register for a life group. Amen? Amen. Pastor's going to come on up and get ready to close today.
Excited about all these groups starting up. And thank you, leaders, for getting up and sharing a little bit about each one, okay? Listen, we're going to take up our tithes and offerings right now. And I'm going to give you an opportunity to just prepare your tithes and offerings, either by your checkbook or giving online, or just using our app. And again, we're not collecting tithes and offerings, but we're going to let you put those in as you're leaving the sanctuary this morning. Let me remind you, at 11:30, we have a parent meeting for all parents of your kids, whatever age bracket they are, from babies all the way up to the fifth grade, fifth grade, I believe it is.
And it's
Odyssey
online.
Kids. You are welcome to stay. We actually encourage you to. We're going to feed you lunch. We're going to feed your kids lunch. And that starts at 11:30. So it's 11:20 right now. And that meeting is going to start right at 11:30 up in Kid Odyssey Room, right upstairs in the Kids Odyssey Room. And your kids are going to be taken care of. And then your kids will be fed. Just along with you, pizza, and it'll be great, okay? So just so you know, you're all welcome, and it's also going to be online, and so if you're online with us this morning, I'm not sure how all that's working, but we will be having that meeting online for you that want to be a part of that as well. We're going to show you one quick video about water baptism, and then I'm just going to bless you guys, and as you're leaving, you give your offering this morning, okay?
What does it mean truly to be washed clean? Going underwater represents your old life, and when you come out of the water, it represents your brand new life with Jesus Christ. I'm showing the whole world through my baptism that I'm basing my life on Jesus Christ, the solid rock. We just need to be cleansed. We just need to be washed clean. When you're in a right relationship with Christ, you can live every single day with the assurance that God is going to give you guidance for your life. Friends, He sets you free.
Yeah. Water baptism is so awesome. And we set it up right here in the sanctuary. And it's just a super great part of the service. And so go to our app, get signed up. And that's going to be a really fun part of our service on the last Sunday of September. Okay, last thing, let's all stand, and I'm going to take a minute to pray for you this morning. If there's anybody that's struggling with some disappointment, discouragement during COVID, I know a lot of people have been getting hit with some discouragement and things like that. Maybe you need healing in your body. Just lift up your hand wherever you are today, and I'm going to pray for you. If you need prayer of any kind, just put your hands up. And what we're going to do is put our hands out toward you and ask God to touch you in a supernatural way. So, church, look around. There are several different people that have put their hands up this morning. And, Lord, I just lift them up to you. I thank you, Lord, that you are able to do exceedingly and abundantly above all that we could ask or think. And I pray blessing over their life. I pray breakthrough over their life. And I thank you, Lord, for a healing touch upon them. Take that discouragement and disappointment. And Father, I thank you that you replace that with joy and peace and confidence. And we thank you and we praise you, Lord, for breakthroughs in their lives this week. And Lord, I pray blessing upon every single one. I thank you, Lord, that this week is going to be an amazing week for them. I pray blessing, favor, and protection over everyone here and everyone that's watching online with us this morning. And Lord, we give you thanks and we give you praise for it. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen and amen. God bless you guys.